So let me share a little bit about myself before I get started. As far as my professional background, my PhD is in forestry from Virginia Tech, but I never even had to take silviculture, so I'm not allowed to call myself a real forester. I'm a forest social scientist or an environmental social scientist. So predominantly my training is in sociology, social psychology, anthropology, and related social science disciplines. But I typically work in multidisciplinary teams with environmental scientists, including biologists and physical scientists like climatologists and geographers. So I work in interdisciplinary teams within the university to try to bring to bear different types of disciplinary knowledge, integrate those knowledges together, and then importantly, also link that knowledge production with the type of knowledge that is also produced within practitioner communities. And so all of you all who work within agencies like the Maricopa County Parks or others are conducting your own research and producing your own knowledge either through scientific endeavors, through management judgment, through other ways of producing relevant information. So trying to link what's produced through the university with what's produced through the practitioner communities, and then integrating those domains into something that can be useful, relevant for making concrete decisions on the ground. So that's really the overarching goal of my scholarship. I've been at ASU for 12 years. As Stacy mentioned, I'm in the School of Community Resources and Development, which is part of the College of Public Programs at ASU. And we have academic programs in Parks and Recreation Management, Tourism Development and Management, and Nonprofit Leadership and Management. So our students, undergraduate, graduate students, have worked with many of you through their internships or through research assistantships, or they've hopefully gone on to work with your agencies after studying with us at ASU. I'm going to thank Kathy Anderek, the director of our school, who's here today as well. So, perhaps the most important thing about me for you all is I'm a member of the Desert Botanical Garden. I have been a member for many years. this is my daughter, Fern, and Fern and I have been coming to the gardens for year after year after year. The Butterfly Pavilion is probably her favorite place, and this is one of the days when we were coming to go to the Butterfly Pavilion, and what she does is she wears as many flowers in her headbands and colorful colors as possible because she wants those butterflies to come land on her. Excellent. And I've also just been really inspired by all of the different creative art installations and other programs and services that happen at the garden. One of my favorite was the bugs that were throughout the gardens a few last year or the year before. And I'm really excited to be working also with Kathy Anderek and another team from ASU who's going to be collaborating with the gardens here on a study to examine the economic impact of the Chihuly exhibit that's going to be returning, as well as some of the visitor experience elements of the Chihuly exhibit. So it's a great partnership that we have with the gardens, and I'm happy to continue to contribute to that. So my overarching question, sort of the big question that I'm addressing in this talk and in some of my scholarship, is how do we evaluate success in achieving the goals that we have for providing high-quality visitor experiences while also maintaining the conservation goals and resource protection goals. And for any of us who work in this arena, this is the central question of our work, is how do we fulfill these dual mandates, which sometimes can either be in conflict or can be perceived to be in conflict. How do we deal with achieving these mandates, and specifically, how do we know when we're achieving success? And so that's the big picture question. And more specifically, what I'm interested in is how do we develop what we call indicators and standards for visitor experience and for research protection within parks and protected areas. So for those of you who have worked in this field, you may be, or in other areas of management, this is an approach that's been adapted to a variety of different perspectives, parks and recreation management, as well as other business and professional endeavors. And it's a fairly straightforward process of management by objectives with indicators and standards. And so this is, I'll spend a moment or two here on this slide. It's the overarching process, and some of my students from my natural resource recreation planning and management class are here as well. And so this is what I'm trying to get across in terms of the big picture process with my students, and that is, it's really many interrelated steps, but if we could break it down into three distinct phases. The first thing that we need to think about doing is crafting specific goals and objectives in terms of what we call desired conditions for both the for the empirically based or observationally based indicators and standards. And for most of the talk, what I'm going to be doing is going through two specific examples of how we've applied this framework within parks and protected areas. And so you'll get to see what I mean by some of these terms. So we want to specify specific goals and objectives in terms of the conditions, and then monitor visitor use levels and the associated conditions of experience quality. And here we're going to talk about needing two distinct types of information and data. We're going to need descriptive information. What are the use levels? What is the visitation level to your park? What are the temporal and spatial dimensions of the visitation? When do people come? Where do they visit? So we need some descriptive data. We also ideally have information that is connecting the visitor use level or the visitor activity with the conditions on the ground. So what is the empirical relationship between a certain number of visitors and a specific impact, right? So for instance, we'll talk in part of the discussion about recreational impacts to trail resources. Right? So it's not enough to know how many visitors are coming and where they're coming. You also have to know what's the empirical relationship between the number, type, amount, distribution of those visitors and a specific resource impact like the incision or erosion rates on trails. Okay? And these things are affected by a variety of other factors, such as in the case of trails, soil type and composition, the other ecological attributes of the area in which you're operating, plus the visitor's behavior. So it actually becomes much more complex to try and decipher those relationships than it may seem at first glance. So then we have to go through monitoring visitor use levels and the associated conditions of experience quality, so not only the environmental resource, but also the visitor's social, cognitive, behavioral aspects. And then evaluate specific use levels in comparison with visitor-informed, and I stress this, visitor-informed standards of quality to assess the degree to which we're achieving our management objectives. And I'm going to return to that point because it's not simply visitor-derived standards of quality, right? Parks and Recreation and other resource management is a profession with judgment. Plus, there are legislative mandates, other policy guidelines. We do not simply allow the visitors' perspectives of our issues to drive our decision-making entirely. Of course, in particularly public lands management, the visitor or other stakeholder input is critical into the decision-making process, but it's not the only input. We have to apply a variety of other considerations to come up with what the standard is. So, That's good.
Okay.
Go back one, I think. Right there. Okay. So there are a couple of key terms that I want to define as we go through the discussion. We're going to talk about objectives, indicators, and standards-based adaptive management. That's the process that I'm going to overview. So first of all, capacity. You have heard this term discussed within the management realm as well as the research realm for about 40 years now, and this is the term of carrying capacity, it's sometimes called, more recently described as visitor use capacity. So the idea is that there is some capacity to provide a particular set of experiences and to provide a particular set of resource conditions, right? Now, importantly, that capacity is not a magic number. It's not a single visitor use level that your park should say our visitor capacity is. The capacity is actually determined by a variety of factors. It can be affected by your physical facilities. Okay. So for instance, when we were talking with the folks at the garden the other day about the Chihuly exhibit and you're going to have staggered times for visiting, part of that is not driven necessarily by the visitor experience. Would the visitors be perceived crowding or have an unsatisfactory experience at slightly higher use levels? Maybe, maybe not. In part, you're constrained by the parking, right? So there's a facility constraint on your capacity, right? So sometimes it's the facility that's constraining your capacity. Other times it may be the visitor experience, right? It may be that at certain use levels, the visitor experience satisfaction degrades below an acceptable level, and so it's actually the social dimension of capacity. That's the constraining factor. In other cases, it's an environmental resource consideration. Okay, it may be, for instance, in Karchner Caverns, we close the caverns, one of the main caverns for a significant part of the year to provide for habitat for, is it bats?
Bats.
So we provide bat habitat, right? And so that's an environmental, in this case, a species-related capacity determination, right? And in other cases, there may be managerial or policy-relevant capacity determinations in federally designated wilderness areas, in many areas, based on the mandate to provide solitude or a primitive and unconfined type of recreation. There are visitor use limits that may include group limits, no more than 12 heartbeats at a time in an area, you know, in a group. It may include total number of visitors within a particular zone. Okay? So each of these dimensions can be the constraining factor in a capacity determination. And in fact, much of the recent scholarship from the academic community has said that we should not focus on a numerical capacity, not say that the capacity is derived from a particular use level, but say that the capacity is derived from the relationship between a certain use level and the desired conditions. Okay? So let your objectives drive the decision making about the number, type, quantity, distribution of visitors. Don't let that number be the driver. So management objectives, these things are typically more broad narrative statements about the level of resource protection and the type and quality of the experience to be maintained. And these will differ based on the resource. So whether you're in Maricopa County Park or you're in the Civic Space Park downtown, you're gonna in that area, and what type of environmental conditions are you trying to maintain? Okay? So those are sort of the sideboards for the more specific conversation that we're going to have. So within that framework, we've been arguing within the academic and some of the practitioner community for many years that we should focus on this approach of using indicators and standards combined with an adaptive approach to management. So indicators are simply measurable, manageable variables that are proxies for those objectives. These are things we cannot easily observe satisfaction, right? You cannot observe forest health. Okay? You have to have things that are observable, empirically available information to set as proxies. The example I like to give to my students is think about something as complex as human biology. Think about your individual human health, right? And how many complex interrelated systems that are operating that are necessary to keep the human body going. But yet, if an EMT rushes to your side, right, that EMT within 3 to 5 steps can make a fairly decent determination of your health. Okay? So that EMT might rush up and say, blood pressure, heart rate, respiration rate, right? Those are indicators of health. Now, are those indicators really representing the full complexity of the biological system in your body? Not quite, but they're pretty darn good proxies for do I tend to this person and do I move on to the next person in a triage situation? What we're looking for are those indicators for more complex systems. What are the things that we can point out and say these are representative of much more complex processes? And if we watch these indicators, those things can be proxies for the more complex systems. And then the standards of quality become benchmarks by which the achievement of our objectives is judged. So some characteristics of these two things, indicators. When you choose indicators, part of this talk is really about, well, where do we come up with these things? How do we develop indicators and standards in this framework? First of all, we need to think about, well, what an indicator should be. And it should be something that's specific, objective, and reliable, meaning it's repeatable. We can measure it over time, and each time we measure it, we're going to get a consistent measurement of that same thing. It's related in some way to visitor use. There are indicators of both ecosystem quality or visitor experience quality that we could monitor, but if they're unrelated to visitor use, which is the primary thing that we have to manage, right? It may not be of great importance to us to manage that, to monitor that. They need to be sensitive. So if the conditions change, the level of the indicator changes, right? So that we know that there's a change in the environment. They need to be manageable in that we have some sway over the processes that are affecting that indicator. And they need to be significant. They need to be tied to the underlying process. The standards then, typically, they are quantitative, meaning that they've got some numerical definition to them. They're time and space bound, meaning we're saying over a particular time period. During the high use season, you may have a set, different set of experience indicators during the off season. Okay? Then you may have a different set of indicators if you'd use a zoning system, right? If you have recreation opportunity spectrum or some other similar related zoning system, you may have different standards for different zones within your area. And we try to express them as a probability and make them impact-oriented and realistic. Okay? You have to think about these things in terms of being achievable standards. Okay? So I'm going to give you two examples of how this plays out. The first example is going to be the development of a social conditions indicator, and the second example is going to be the development of an ecological conditions indicator. Okay? And then we can have some time to discuss other examples that you may have done in your own experiences or just a general comment. So the first is Yosemite National Park. So unfortunately, the parks, as we all know, are closed right now.
Not the state parks.
I did see a news story about the boom in tourism in Sedona over the last couple weeks. They have been benefiting from the tourists going to Sedona. So I have been working with Yosemite National Park, and I want to say that although the examples that I'm going to give are from Yosemite National Park and then some other from Forest Service, BLM, and county parklands, this entire process is transferable. This can play out in the desert botanical gardens, in a small city park, in a county park. It's the process that I want to illustrate. So Yosemite, we've been working, my team in Yosemite, for about 7 years. Yosemite, if you don't know, is located in California, about 2.5 hour drive from Fresno, if that's where I typically fly into. It's a very, very large park. It has a very, very significant size of wilderness area, and most of the park is designated wilderness. What's interesting is, actually, can you hand me that zapper? I can use the laser pointer at least. Yosemite Valley, this area here, is a valley which is only approximately 12 miles long and 1 mile wide, right? Yet it receives 90% of all the visitor use to the park. And during the heaviest use periods, right prior to the initiation of our research, they were receiving approximately 7,000 automobiles a day into Yosemite Valley. One of the interesting questions is, well, okay, can they accommodate that? Well, they didn't even really know exactly how many parking spaces they had in the valley, because it's funny when you work with transportation people, first thing we need to know is how many parking spaces do you have in there? I was like, well, depends on if Dave Henderson is parking the people by thing or if they're parking themselves, right? Because Dave Henderson gets 400 extra spaces out of the same thing. Depends on what you consider a parking space. So some of our first descriptive information was a lot. We were like, well, that's okay. Well, let's put some bounds, plus and minus, right? But plus or minus about 4,000 parking spaces in the valley. So there's exceeded the physical capacity of the valley to park all of those cars. Led to a whole host of problems, right? So traffic congestion, delays, localized air pollution, wildlife disturbance, vegetation disturbance, et cetera, et cetera. The list goes on and on and on. Anyone who's visited Yosemite in the last 10, 20 years knows of these problems. Well, one of the things that we try to do is first go back and understand the conditions that led. So we don't always go back to the late 19th century, but in the case of Yosemite, we first wrote a paper where we tried to understand, well, what is the visitor experience of traveling in the park? And the point being, we need to find what those indicators are. Okay, what are the indicators of the experience? What do people care about? What makes a meaningful visitor experience, particularly related to the travel dimension of the park? So we looked back historically, and you know, we did a paper about the historical geography of Yosemite and learned that, you know, the early visitors came over horse-drawn stages, dusty roads, climbing perilously close to the steep slopes. Even by 1926, this is the first director of the National Park Service, Stephen Mather, speaking at the first dedication of the all-year highway into the park. In 1926, in that speech, Stephen Mather talked about the tension that he was facing in visitor use and development for auto-related infrastructure versus resource protection and protecting a high-quality experience. So this is a problem that's gone back 100 years in Yosemite. These are some of the early, I love these old, these are from the NPS historic photo collection. These are the early touring carriages within Yosemite. The tunnel tree, right? Up there in the near the Mariposa Grove of giant sequoias. By the 1940s, you're starting to see the expansion in outdoor recreation participation in the United States, especially in the post-war era, the development of a greater leisure class, the development of the expansion of the highway system, the road network, and the growth of the personal automobile really starts to change the way that visitors have experienced the park from the preceding 50 to 60 years, because they had precedingly been in a much more intimate, direct contact with the park through the horses, the carriages, and the touring motor cars. The automobile starts to separate the visitor from the park around this time. By the 1980s and into the 90s, the park is beginning to address these. They developed a whole host of solutions. They removed automobile driving entirely from the eastern side of Yosemite Valley. They instituted a dual fuel shuttle bus system. It's alternative transportation. It is voluntary, but it's a good, fairly good alternative transportation system. And still today, in our studies that we conducted as early as in 2007, as many as 90 to 95% of all visitors arrive to Yosemite in their car, personal automobile, despite the presence of a regional rapid transit system, the YARTS, Yosemite Area Rapid Transit, where you can park in Mariposa Grove or in town of Mariposa or other ring communities and take the YARTS in. We found less than 1% of visitors to the park took advantage of that, even though you get a discount. If you pay the ticket for the bus, it gets you a discount to get into the park. So one of the things we're trying to understand is, what's the visitor experience of travel and what are the important dimensions of it so that we can understand how to create indicators? Okay. So we published our first study that looked at understanding the visitor experience of the transportation system using that historical and cultural anthropology perspective. We explored through qualitative interviews, and this is often an excellent approach for the first stages of understanding a visitor experience, of just talking to people with as simple questions as, you know, what are the pros and cons? Like, you know, what did you enjoy most about this visit? What did you enjoy least about this visit? Trying to get that kind of information to elicit what's the salient, significant aspect of their visit. We identified the potential indicators, right? So we identified the critical visitor experience dimensions as being things like a sense of freedom. This was a critical part of the experience of traveling while in the park, that people valued highly having a sense of freedom, being able to do what one visitor called, in his own words, to go where I want, when I want. Right? And so that was one of the reasons that we were driving the behavior toward the automobile, right? Is because they value freedom. That's the underlying thing that they want. How are they getting it? They're using the personal automobile to be able to go to which waterfall in which order and visit the park as they want it. We also identified stress and conflict as an important dimension of the experience that was associated with that driving, right? So people want the freedom. They actually are willing to accept some of the stress and conflict along to get the freedom. And then the third and salient dimension was the experience of the environment, the actual interaction with the natural and physical environment, which they recognized was also slightly diminished by survey questionnaire as part of this project for the next phase of the study. And in this paper, we documented their choices, you know, who is choosing to ride which kind of transportation, private automobiles or Yosemite shuttle buses, and we compared their evaluations of these different dimensions of the experience, of the functional dimension, get where I want, when I want, being able to have adequate parking space, and also started to explore some of the trade-offs, right? Because this is where it starts to get interesting is, well, these things are trade-offs, right? And visitors do recognize that. They recognize that, you know, if I want pristine environment and high solitude, that may mean I have a lower probability of entering that area when I want, right? Or I have to get a use permit or something. They understand these trade-offs. Okay. And so the most recent paper was assessing and then using some computer simulation modeling to evaluate the visitors, and the use of scenario planning ties in here to be able to look at, well, doing modeling experiments. What if we raise use, lower use? What if we change the seasonality of use? If we have the empirical data and we have the information on the visitors' evaluations of the conditions, we can start to use some simulation modeling to say, well, what if we added 3,000 more cars? What if we took 3,000 more cars away? Right? What if we shifted 30% of the visitation from the automobiles to the park shuttle bus? How would that affect shuttle bus operations? How would that affect the timing and frequency and number of buses needed? So we start to get into some of the operational questions with this. So we formulated and defined the indicators of quality for the experience, modeled the relationship between the park use levels and the specific indicators, and then we developed the evaluative standards for the indicator variables and simulated different conditions. And so, next. The next thing I'm going to do is do a quick, we don't have to do these, but this is a handout, so pass these around. So first of all, the student walks up and in a very professional way says, "Hello, my name is Dave White. I'm from Arizona State University. I'm working with the National Park Service on a visitor experience survey. We'd like 15 minutes of your time. Your opinion really matters. Because we're doing a random sample, just your perspective represents the voices of 2,000 other visitors." Right? We've got a nice color postcard for you to participate in this. Yeah. They go through 5 other pages of questions, right? We would like to know how many vehicles could use the roadways without it being too congested. To help judge this, we have a series of photographs that show different numbers of vehicles on the roadways. Please look at the photographs. Rate each photograph by indicating how acceptable you find it based on the number of vehicles shown. A rating of -4 means the number of vehicles is very unacceptable, and +4 means the number of vehicles is very acceptable. Okay, Stacy, can you go? So, in your head, somewhere in the range of +4 to -4. Right? Think about how acceptable that picture is. Next. All right. Just one at a time, Stacy.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So that's number 2.
Picture 2.
Yeah.
Are we ready?
Picture 3. Picture 4. Picture 5. Picture 6. Okay. So we can say there. So you can see those are 6 identical photos. Are actually used photo manipulation, Photoshop software. None of those things actually ever happened. We did at some point capture each one of those cars driving, but then we created these photorealistic simulation photos. What we did is we randomly presented them in order, right? So each respondent was shown the photos in a randomly designed order, so it wasn't shown most to least, or least to most, et cetera, right? So I just picked a random order for your presentation. And we used their evaluations. Now, what's happening here is what we have an indicator that's commonly, or actually we developed what is being now commonly implemented, called VPV, or Vehicles Per Viewshed. Right? This is essentially analogous to another indicator that's commonly used as people at one time, okay, on park sites. So how many people in a snapshot if you're at a destination attraction, right? Take a snapshot in time, how many people are at that attraction at that one time in point. And then if you know the relationship between that level of use and the visitor's evaluation of that level of use, right? Then you've got an indicator that you can use to say how is it related to a particular experience quality. So if you go to the next slide, what we've done is created what's called a norm curve, right? And this is just plotting the data. This is the real data from the visitors in this study. And we've got vehicles per viewshed here, which go from 0, the picture with no vehicles, which had a mean score of almost exactly 4.0 that was highly acceptable to everyone in the study. Okay. And we have a mean score down here of almost -4. That was, 19 or so vehicles per view shed. And that was highly unacceptable to almost everyone in the study. And this gives you a norm curve. This is based on a theory from social psychology, normative theory, which suggests that people have individual standards for particular types of behavior and evaluating particular conditions. What's your individual standard about the acceptable speed limit? Right? There's the posted standard, which is the management standard, right? What's your individual standard? Is it at the speed limit, 5 miles over, 7 miles over, 11 miles over, right? When the speed limit cameras were out there, everybody was at 11 miles over the speed limit. It was consistent throughout the whole valley because everybody knew they were set right at 11 miles over, right? So everything flowed nice and evenly everywhere. But here, so we plot this, next slide, and see what we get here now is we get for management decision making, then we give this to managers and we say, here is a potential range of standards for you to consider. The standard could be set the standard whereby the highest number of visitors will be satisfied. Okay? If you set the standard at no vehicles per view shed, you are going to please almost everyone who is in the park at that time. right? What will it take to get there is the question, right? 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 So, but that is based on the empirical data of the current visitors, that's the optimal condition, right? That's optimum, right? Is no one else there, right? Over here, where this trend line crosses the zero, that's where it starts to go from acceptable to unacceptable. We might call that the minimum acceptable condition. That's at the point at which about half your visitors are unsatisfied and half are satisfied. Okay, right? So that's might be what we term the minimal acceptable condition. Right? And anywhere in here is the range of acceptable conditions. So if you are managing to somewhere between 0 and 11 vehicles per viewshed, right, you're within a range of acceptable conditions. It's up to management, based on a variety of other factors, to set the target. What is that target going to be? Right? So what we've done then is the rest of the section of the survey asks people to evaluate, once they've seen the whole suite of photos, now they look at each of the photos. And we say, which one of these photos represents your preferred condition? Right? So it's kind of getting in that optimal. And we see in both, we did different photo simulations for the Yosemite Valley versus the high country, because they're different environments, both managerial and environmental. And then we asked them, well, what did you expect to see? Right? What did you experience? This is important because from expectancy valence theory, it tells us that people often define satisfaction as the difference between expected outcomes and achieved outcomes. Right? If you, and every manager knows this of like a customer of a retail store, if you exceed expectations, people usually report satisfaction. Right? So we want to know, what did you expect and what did you experience? Actually, in this case, the expected conditions were worse than the experience conditions for both of these. And this is partially because of Yosemite's terrible reputation. And it works to their advantage sometime. Because people get there and they're like, oh my God, I thought it was going to be gridlock all day and night, and it really wasn't that bad. That's one way to exceed expectations, right? Is lower expectations. And, you know, and we've had a variety of political candidates who have taken that strategy, like going into debates, right? That's usually the way, like, well, if he says a whole sentence, it's going to be better than we expect, you know? We ask them, at what point should the Park Service, quote unquote, do something about it? Okay? And we give some examples of what that do might mean. And then we ask them, at what point would you no longer visit this park? Right? That's called the displacement dimension. So this is further information to say, look, this is what your visitors prefer, expect, think they experience. This is where they think you should do something. And this is where they may stop coming to your area or be displaced to another area of the park. So again, it gives managers more information and a range of information. So from this, we could develop an indicator variable such as vehicles per viewshed, which is a proxy for the visitor's experience of freedom. We can take that same information from the photo simulations and convert that into a density, a traditional traffic density, you know, cars per square foot, right? We can convert it into other variables. We can then use a visitor-based evaluative standard. One way of suggesting that we, in the report, would be to say something like, there's a 90% probability that the median VPV, or vehicles per viewshed, will be between 0 and 11 on Yosemite Valley roadways during the busy to busier use periods. Right? Now, why do I frame it this way? A, it's realistic. Right? We had some traffic engineering folks working with us on this study. Right? There are certain days, there are probably about, we called them 6 days, throughout the year where there will be no way to achieve this standard. It will be impossible on your busiest days to ever achieve this standard. Right? The Park Service calls those 100 days between Labor Day and Memorial Day the 100 days of hell. Right? And in those 100 days of hell, there are 6 days where you're never going to achieve your management objectives. Right? Because there's 4th of July weekend, Memorial Day weekend, Labor Day weekend. You've got to build yourself some management cushion to understand you're just going to exceed capacity on some days. Right? And then you express it in terms of a probability because there's also, you know, you're allowing for some conditions to change over time. You give yourself a range for your goal, and you give yourself a particular spatial and temporal dimension. Other considerations then become your own judgment, ecological conditions, and other factors that have to feature in legislative and policy mandates. Okay. So then working with the Park Service to establish capacity, what we've done is we've combined a couple of different research teams and computer simulation models. So we're able to look at the number of people who arrive at the park. So we know this from the visitor use levels, the statistics from the agency. How many people arrive at the park each day? Right? We're able to use a model that relates park entrances to recreation use at different sites around the area. So we've actually surveyed people at the park entrances, and then we've found out through other empirical observations where those people go and how long they go there and what sequence of attractions they visit, right? So now we can predict if a car hits the entrance station, it's going to be at Bridal Veil Falls in 3 hours. And it's going to spend 17 minutes at Bridal Veil Falls, and then it's going to be somewhere else in the next hour, and then it's going to be somewhere else. Putting enough data together, you can find a pattern of visitation spatially and temporally through the park. Okay, so we simulate that park, and we figure out, well, when are they going to arrive at sites, and what are they going to do at the sites? We have another simulation model that simulates their behavior at the recreation site. And we survey them for experiential conditions on the site and while driving. We develop a road indicator and a site indicator for their standards. And so in this case, if you're looking to set capacity based, for instance, on physical capacity, you would need to shut down the park entrance when Bridal Veil Falls parking lot fills up, right? So that's your early warning indicator. When Bridal Veil Falls parking lot fills up, you know that you're beginning to start, and you're going to see problems that are going to ripple throughout the park the rest of the day. So the time at first fill up for Bridal Veil became one of our quick decision-making proxies for the managers. When Bridal Veil starts to fill up, they start deferring people at the park entrance to other locations. You should try going to Mariposa Grove this morning instead. You're going to be crowded down there. Go somewhere else. So they can start to think proactively. This is a project that we worked with that was funded partially by the Bureau of Land Management and also by Shimano, the mountain bike component manufacturer and fishing tackle. Their corporate of environmental and social responsibility office has realized that if they don't start helping provide research and support and information to their land management partners, that they will quickly be out of business. As mountain bikes and other recreation impacts are studied and managed, that they've started to worry that, look, this is going to affect our bottom line. So they teamed up with the BLM and ASU and other partners from around Arizona, including RAND, helped a lot with the study in Maricopa County Parks. And we were trying to understand first the relationship between mountain bike as an activity and specific recreation trail impacts. So what we did is we were looking specifically at soil. We did a big literature review, and we studied, and we found soil impacts to be one of the most important concerns as far as the environmental conditions side, right, as opposed to conflict or crowding on the social side. For the environmental side, soil impacts, we were tying this into a National Mountain Biking Strategic Action Plan that had been developed, so we were trying to provide research that would help move that plan forward. And we examined the effects of a couple different factors that we knew were associated with the actual impact. One was the slope or the grade of the trail, and one was the ecological attributes of the surrounding environment and the trail use level on two indicators for trail conditions, maximum trail incision and trail width. These were two that are related to soil disturbance. And our study, we used a trail impact assessment, two techniques, a multi-parameter point sampling and a problem assessment approach. So the multi-parameter point sampling says that you start at a random start point, say, you know, use a random number generator, and you say, okay, I'm going to start 7 feet into my trail, right? And then you set a sampling interval distance based on the necessary sampling size you need. So you say, okay, in this case, it was about a quarter mile. So I'm going to start, say, 7 feet in, and then every quarter mile, I'm going to stop, right? And I'm going to go, and I'm going to do trail measurements. And we measured, I think, you know, I don't know, 200 variables at each stop, right? And among those were trail width and trail depth, but we also measured things like vegetation type, soil type, et cetera, et cetera. So then we also, because we didn't want to miss other problems that wouldn't, you know, using a random sampling approach, you should get a representative sample of your trail. But we also wanted to make sure we didn't miss any other major problems, so we did a problem impact assessment, which is whenever we encountered certain things, right, like trails crossing streams, right, we just would stop and sample there, whether they were part of the random selection or not. So some of our graduate students, Grant and Troy, got to ride mountain bikes all over the Western United States for their thesis, and that was one of the best projects, yeah. Come study at School of Community Resources and Development at ASU, right? Well, we did the science, and we found that the impact parameters, maximum incision in particular, in this example, was greater at slopes of 5 to 10% than of slopes at less than 5% in all of the five different ecoregions that we studied in the area. So we were looking at Colorado Plateau, the Wasatch and Uinta Mountains, Southern Rockies, Arizona, New Mexico Mountains, and Sonoran Basin and Range were five areas that we were studying. And in all five of those areas, as the slope or grade of the trail increased from 5% to 10%, in all five areas, the mean maximum trail incision went up. Okay. In some of them, the relationship was a little bit more complicated later, so that they would actually, in this instance, it lowered from the 5% to 10% to the greater than 10%, but still, basically, you're going up. The trend lines are up for each of these, with one or two exceptions, and we tried to explain those anomalies in the discussion section. But if you go to the next slide, what we found was the example is, what's the indicator variable? In this case, it's maximum trail incision. Based on the research, we suggested, well, a possible standard would be for 90% of trail miles, the average grade should be below 10%. Right? Again, there are going to be certain sections of your trails where you're going to have higher trail grades, right? And that's okay. Right? But on the whole, for a trail design standard, this would be one way to interpret the results. But again, then you combine this with a variety of other inputs, like your management judgment, your relationship, rider preferences for the kinds of trails, right? Because there are other ways than just keeping a modest grade to manage those resources, right? You could harden the resource, you could put in some, you know, other ways to keep the soil from eroding, right? So if you want to have nice steep grades, you just have to make the trails more resistant to the impact. And so those are the two examples. So I'm just going to return to the adaptive visitor use management framework that I began with and say that, again, we're trying to create these specific objectives in terms of the desired conditions, develop empirically based indicators and standards. I didn't talk much about monitoring, but we try to create indicators that the partners then can monitor easily, efficiently over time. So maximum trail incision at places along the trail, you know, we took GPS coordinates, we took photo coordinates, so each of the trail partners that we worked with could go back over time to that same GPS, take the measurement, take another photograph, and monitor that over time. And then we use a variety of tools to monitor and then evaluate the use levels in relation to the informed standards of quality. And with that, I say that there are a variety of resources. I've sent several of these papers to Stacy, and I'd be happy to share any more of these with any of you who are interested. And Stacy can have a copy of the presentation if you'd like to email it out. It'd be fine with me. Okay, great. Thank you. And I won't. If you have to go, I won't be offended. So anybody who needs to run off, please do. And then we have about 5 or 7 minutes if we want to do questions. So the question is related to establishing visitor use capacity for, in this case, trails and considerations like weather. And so, for instance, we've known that wet conditions on trails can really exacerbate erosion, particularly with certain activities like mountain biking and equestrian use, right? So if you've got wet trails and you've got horses and mountain bikes, can really do a lot of impact in a short period of time. And so I just would include that in the ecological or environmental conditions factor of determining capacity. So yes, I mean, what I had mentioned was the sort of ecological attributes of the region are one. So whether you have sandy soil or loamy soil or clay soil, that's one thing to consider, because different soils have different erosion potential. And then on top of that are the more short-term weather-related environmental considerations, like, and those things are important to write into your planning documents and your standards as far as, you know, saying it, because a lot of times this is giving you the management justification to make specific decisions. Right, so you can say, we are going to close the trail system, or we are going to make a specific decision today, and we have a documented rationale for that. The rationale is, this is the experience and the resource condition we're trying to provide, and this is the variable that we're watching, and one of the critical things that we're watching is the muddiness of the trail. That's been exceeded today, and then we have a set of management actions that are triggered by the standard being exceeded. So I didn't get into what do you do when your standards are exceeded, right? There are a couple things. You trigger management actions, or, and this is not, you know, being facetious, you change your standard. Right? Because oftentimes we set unrealistic standards, right? And so then you observe and monitor over time. It could be that you had an inappropriate standard, right? Your standard was too stringent, or possibly, you know, too lenient. So you can do each, and that's the adaptive part, and that's the sort of experimental going back and learning management and learning. So the question is about specific sensitive environmental resources like tundra or other sensitive environmental resources. And this is where working with folks like Nancy Grimm and others from the School of Life Sciences and you know, our biologist and plant ecologist colleagues at the university, we need to know some of that information. Right? What are the sensitive species? What are the potential times for recovery? You know, where do we need to watch out for? Both in terms of plants, but also in threatened and endangered species and those kinds of things. In our study, looking at recreational impacts from mountain biking, the most significant, ecologically significant impact was determined to be potential impacts to desert tortoise habitat and desert tortoises themselves, right? In fact, the small amount although I know it makes us crazy as trail people and managers, right? The ecological significance of the trail impacts in terms of the soil erosion that we were seeing were fairly modest, except in certain circumstances near streams and other things. So they bother us, they're visually upsetting, but as far as how are they affecting ecosystem functions and processes, not much compared to some other things, right, that we should be more concerned about, perhaps. Nancy? The question is about the utility of indicators and their ability to really represent complex systems, and also sort of different times like the busiest day at Yosemite. So in response to the first question, I agree. I mean, I know we've faced this not only with indicators for things like parks and recreation resource conditions, but thinking about more complex sets of indicators like economic indicators. We all look at the stock market as an economic indicator, and it's a terrible indicator. It's a trailing indicator. It's an only indicator for one part of the economy, right? But climate change is, you know, we're all sort of obsessed with parts per million of global CO2 concentrations, and we're missing all sorts of other things because of that. So I agree with the critique. I think that I don't think it undermines the utility of indicators as a technique for managing, because I think otherwise we get into the trap of managing to existing conditions and allowing oftentimes sort of the slow degradation of existing conditions, for at least not watching something. And that's a great, perfect. So you're thinking like construct validity in the research world, right? So you've got this complicated thing like ecosystem health, and one indicator is not going to be representative of that thing. So we would have, and we always do, have a suite of indicators. And so for even something like the transportation experience quality in Yosemite, we derived, now it also is, you have to balance out the number of indicators with your ability to monitor them. And so we ended up with three indicators just for transportation experience. This was part of a larger environmental impact statement that was done for the park. So there were indicators for all sorts, for the biology, for ecosystems and such. So there was a suite of, you know, on the order of dozens of indicators. We used vehicles per view shed. We also used travel times, right, is a common one because it helps tie into the more the larger field of urban transportation management and the sort of classes of transportation systems, like class A system. You know, when you're operating, if you've got certain classes, so we were able to tie into that. So if you have multiple indicators that are representing this construct, you have a better idea of getting the suite. And then to your second question, I should have said that I probably gave the impression that we sort of give up on those busy days. We don't really give up. We do have separate sets of standards, right? So and yes, the toolkit is exactly what we do is that there are standards, and if you exceed those standards, there are a set of options. And so the managers have been doing this intuitively forever, and so one of the important lessons I've learned in a variety of my projects is to shut up and go listen to people who are doing this. And so when I went to Yosemite the first time, and I just got Dave Henderson, the traffic manager for Yosemite, you know, and I told me, I said, Dave, how do you know when things are going bad? You know, what are the things, and what do you do? And Dave had already figured out this thing he called the shunt. Right, and that's when he knew when certain things were going bad, he would basically use his traffic managers to shunt people to different, like in the heart, you know, he would just shut off certain roads, and a lot of times he was just doing it with like, oh, we're under construction, you know, and it was just causing people to loop, or, you know, they were doing all sorts of active management at the time. And so we have now, but we're trying to do it a little more proactively and a little more systematically, Dave's sort of judgment and intuition was incredibly influential in what that pool of options would be. But now it's able to be where certain numbers at the front entrance stations get triggered and they start the management actions down the chain, right? So those are exactly the kinds of things, a whole toolkit of stuff and up to and including. Now, then you get to the interface of not only science and management, but politics, because we will, you know, other than the government shutdown, they will never turn a visitor away from a national park front gate. It's just not going to happen. We will put use limits on wilderness areas. We will put use limits on rivers. We're not going to turn someone away from the front gate. And that just comes down from history and policy from above. And so, you know, we've been talking for over 40 years about a mandatory shuttle system at Yosemite, but it will not happen in our lifetime or ever, probably, because of the politics involved, right? Because there are six different tourist communities. Where does that shuttle start, right? And there's more than one congressional representative. You know, it's tough. I mean, I'm certainly sympathetic, but it's actually, you know, so I teach in my class about the sort of hierarchy, right? That you've got legislation, policy mandates, you know, organizational strategy, et cetera, et cetera. What I'm describing here is mostly at, you know, the level of operations, right? When you're, and it's, it may or may not, as much as I would want it to be, you know, it may or may not have any real relevance for a higher level policy discussion about whether it's good transportation and conservation policy to take the 202 around that side of the mountain. I mean, that's actually more of a question that is, it's an interface of science and policy question, but it's got a much heavier policy element to it, right? It's probably best played out through sort of the democratic governance situations, you know, and so I don't know. You know, you could develop some indicators of ecosystem functioning for South Mountain, right? And say that if you lose these 40 acres, how is that going to affect, you know, ecosystem functions or whatever? And that may be useful. And some of the social, you know, values in terms of, you know, their value for a certain variety and length of trails and those kinds of things. But, you know, again, once it gets into that policy process with all that political, it's hard. Yeah, oh, I'm sympathetic. I give these kinds of presentations. I worked with the city of Phoenix on some recent studies and gave a series of presentations to the parks, the subcommittee for parks from the city council. And you know, it's hard because we're academics and we like to bracket things with uncertainty and preserve a little bit of flexibility in our interpretations and such, and they want to know how many parking spaces go at Echo Canyon. You know, what's the capacity? Tell me, what's the number? Tell me the number of parking spaces, you know, that we should put at Echo Canyon. You know, and I can't really answer that.